Welcome to the third session for today. We have with us Mr. Bhupendra Pratap Singh, who will be conducting the third session. And before we begin the third session, let me introduce Mr. Bhupendra Pratap Singh to all of you. So Mr. Bhupendra is currently IoT Product Manager at Bliss Healthcare. He completed his graduation in Electronics and Communication Engineering from SMVDU Jammu and Kashmir and PG Diploma in Internet of Things from CDAC Pune. Currently, he works at Bliss Healthcare as an IoT Product Manager in the healthcare domain and also as guest faculty at CDAC Pune for NSQF Level 8 Diploma courses in Embedded System Design and Internet of Things. Before joining Bliss Healthcare, he worked for CDAC Pune from September 2017 to August 2020 in R&D and training domain. And he is a skilled polyglot programmer and carries rich experience in distributed ledger technologies, wireless sensor networks, edge computing frameworks, cloud native applications, embedded Linux, tech stack, and also communicating technical results and concepts to audience with various backgrounds. He has a thorough understanding of socket programming, C, Python, Node.js, SQL, time series databases, Prometheus, Docker, Kubernetes, Grafana, and other computing frameworks and languages. He has also published 10 research papers in reputed journals and conferences, and delivered technical talks at various conferences and engineering colleges. He was one of the key members from CDAC to deliver technical talks for capacity building in IoT in Northeast region under a workshop on emerging technologies, innovation, incubation, and entrepreneurship development, sponsored by the Ministry of Electronics and IT, Government of India, from December 2018 to February 2019. He also loves teaching and open source and is keen on FOSS adoption among student community and keeps exploring emerging technologies, especially open source trends in the core domain areas. So with that, I would welcome you, Bhupendra. I hope all is well with you.
Thank you, sir, for nice introduction. So I think we can start now, right?
Yes, we can start.
So my slide is visible, sir? I think it would be visible.
Yes, right? Yes, it is visible, yes.
Okay. So before I begin, I would like to thank you, sir, for inviting me on this prestigious platform where we can interact and we can discuss about the ongoing developments in IoT ecosystem. So while we talk about IoT, I think initial sessions you have gone through, so you might have gotten a fair idea about how your IoT ecosystem works. That requires various and that requires understanding of various technologies that extends from your electronics to computer science, and then of course if you are going in more in other integrating sections like mechanical engineering and electrical engineering, so it's like something that requires interdisciplinary knowledge. But apart from this, your programming becomes the core part of it, right? Because ultimately you have to control the devices, you have to interact with the cloud ecosystems, then programming becomes one important part of it. So now question arises, which programming language need to be selected? So this is like very debatable topic, that which particular programming language need to be selected, because in IoT ecosystem, there are three important parts. One is edge or fog. One is like at the lowest end, we talk about like when you are dealing with IoT in the devices or say it modes, and then cloud ecosystem. But still Python gets the edge over any other frameworks. You talk about Java, Node.js, you talk about C programming, C++. And reason behind that is that Python has lot of rich packages, libraries, and then support to the end device, to gateways, and then cloud ecosystem. So we will look at all those perspective. Before that, let's discuss the outline what we are going to cover. So of course 1.5 hours is very less to tick down all the things that require for any programming aspect. But little bit understanding we will try to make, so that once we will be moving to tomorrow's sessions while developing some solutions using IoT protocols like MQTT and then CoAP and then HTTP REST and then cloud connectivity, working on Raspberry Pi based devices or any Linux ecosystem. So we must be at least able to write simple programs to connect our devices to the cloud ecosystem, get some data from the sensor. So for that, whatever basic things required, we will try to touch down in this particular session. So like how you can use like basic interpreter prompt, because Python is more important, need to be understood that it's a dynamic typed language, not a static type language. Might be people will be familiar with C, C++, Java. And then what actually, how you can like write comments, then basically declare variables, rule of indentation, that is one of the important aspect need to be understood while understanding Python. Then basic control flow, if else, while loops and all, then how you can write function and more important modules, because that is one of the important aspect while you will be going with the third party libraries, and then important data structure, list, dictionary and tuples. And then we will try to understand how you can use pip, that is the main package manager, to install any particular packages that is required to develop any particular applications depending on the context. And then we will conclude this session. So first thing, why Python programming is very important for IoT. And nowadays, if you will go for any survey, you will find that Python programming is getting lot of popularity among multiple ecosystem. You talk about IoT, you talk about data science, you talk about even automation sector, where people were preferring shell scripting, but they are now more moving towards the Python. So Python is also, you can use as a programming language, you can also use it as scripting language. So first important aspect is mostly the devices that we use at the edge side, or might be sometimes we are using at the end device also, like Raspberry Pi, BeagleBone Black. And more important, very teeny microcontroller boards, like you talk about ESP32, ESP8266, they are also supporting MicroPython, right? So it means where we were able to write program only in the C ecosystem at the lowest level, now Python libraries are supporting. Even you talk about quantum computing, they are like Atos has developed PyEquaGem, where you can also use Python based, packages for quantum computing also. So Python is becoming popular apart from IoT in all the ecosystem, and IoT is something that enables multiple domains to work together. You talk about embedded system, you talk about wireless sensor networks, you talk about big data technologies, everywhere you need to communicate in IoT. So majorly, if you talk about our FDP that is constructed upon, so we need to understand how we can use this Python in Raspberry Pi boards. To like, suppose if you have to access any particular GPIO, you have to on and off, you have to get some data that is connected with certain GPIO. So all those packages are available, in Python at very large scale. You can find whatever sensor you can buy, like the previous section you've seen, like different kind of sensor, like proximity, temperature, humidity. You talk about soil sensors, all these sensors are now coming with like integration with Raspberry Pi. All those kind of sensors are available in digital format. You don't have to even take care of ADC part and all. So easily you can program those sensors using this particular language called Python. And then more important, if you are going for public platform like AWS, Microsoft Azure, and Google GCP, anywhere you will go, you will easily find the SDK, software development kits, which you can easily use for programming. Even more important, if you are very much interested to program like Bluetooth, low energy, Zigbee, all these, even wireless computing radios, they are also having the Python support. Then core IoT protocols that basically help you to make your data reach to the cloud platform, like MQTT, one of the more practiced protocol in industry. Then you talk about CoAP, that is still getting attention in the industry, but not up to the level that MQTT and REST have. So all these protocols have rich library sets which you can easily use and develop your application in IoT. Open source platform like ThingsBoard, that you require, like suppose you have to connect your Raspberry Pi board to the cloud to visualize your data, perform analytics, anomaly detection, all these things. Easily you can use this particular cloud platform by writing programs in Python. And more important, any particular things, if you are looking in IoT ecosystem, talks about block, you talk about blockchain, you talk about even in more distributed ledger technology that are core oriented for IoT application like IOTA, that is the next generation distributed ledger technology. They also support Python-based SDKs or Python. They have Python-based API. So easily starting from your devices to the data encryption and connecting to the cloud, these things you can do easily with the Python programming language. So if you have a extensive knowledge of Python programming language, you can easily develop your web application that I have not mentioned, but still you have like a framework like Django, you have framework like Flask. If you want to develop your own dashboards and all, you have Python libraries like Plotly. So each and everything is available. If you want to go more in the stat side, you have a lot of libraries ranging from your NumPy, Pandas, Scikit, and machine learning, you have everything. So Python becomes one of the core aspect that can easily connect your data to the visualization, applying your machine learning algorithm, everything you can do with this. So that's why Python become one of the important aspects. So more important that what I believe as a core practitioner of IoT, that until and unless you will, the much you will read, you will get it, but until and unless you will not program it, you will not get the actual programming understanding. So if you want to go on with me writing your program at your end, it would be fun for you also during next 1.5 hours. So there are various, particular tools you can use on your system for writing these programs. Preferably like in industry and all, people have two important aspects. Either you can use PyCharm, that is from especially designed for Python, developing Python applications. So it says both the supports, one is community edition, second is your professional edition. So community edition you can install and you can practice. And the one that is my favorite for any programming language is Visual Studio Code. It's again open source. So Visual Studio Code you can also install and you can easily program it. Otherwise, if you are not okay with these two integrated development environment, you have any text editor ranging from Notepad, if you have in Windows, you can use Nano inbuilt editors on most of the Linux platforms, talk about Ubuntu and all. Then Vim and Vi, all these platforms are pre-installed. But what happens if you are going with a text editor and you are talking about integrated development environments? Integrated development environments like, help you to whatever variables you have already declared, you don't have to again write the whole variable name. So actually it reduces the time of your, programming. So it helps a lot while you are developing bigger applications. But for initially, if you are not want to go with any integrated development environment, you can open any editor that is available on your system and you can use. So for this, first we will start with the command line terminal so that you can understand how you can, launch Python on a terminal without any integrated development and environment. And you can basically print something and see how things works in Python, right? So let's start with this. So this is my Ubuntu based operating system. So you can use any operating system, right? It's like Ubuntu, why I am preferring, because it's a open source, and second important aspect, it has large community support. So if you stuck at some basic problems, you can easily go and find out the solutions, you can write to the community. However, you are open to use in future any particular open source platform like OpenSUSE is there, right? If you are not going to use Ubuntu, you have Kali Linux, you have Cinnamon coming from Ubuntu Mate. So a lot of variants are available. So whatever you are comfortable with, you can use. And Python supports everywhere. Even Alpine kind of Linux that are very, coming with very minimal code footprints. Those kind of operating system you can also use, and Python it supports. So by default, Python is pre-installed on all these platforms. So if you have to test that Python is there or not, you can easily type Python hyphen hyphen version. So like on my system, it's Python 3.8.5. So the current version, that the latest one, is Python 3.19. And I think the date that it was released on 14th November. So before that 3.8.5 came, right? So in October, they have launched 3.8 version. But whatever program I am going to write, it doesn't matter any Python version, if you will write, it will support. So one important aspect also need to be taken care while dealing with Python, like if you might have met other programming languages like Java and all, most of the things are backward compatible, right? It means if your program is written in version 6, it might support in version 7. But the initial that most of the people started their Python journey, they started with Python 2.x version, right? But there are a lot of things that in Python 2.x support, but it doesn't support in Python 3.x. You need to do certain back reverse engineering for it. For example, if you have before I go to give you basic idea about Python 2.x and Python 3.x, so first you can launch Python easily. Just type in your terminal Python and your Python interpreter. So with this 3 greater than sign, it is saying that you are now inside Python interpreter. So more important, while reading any language, we must understand it's a compiler based language and it's interpreter based language, right? So Python is interpreter based language. It means the code execution and check everything happens line by line, right? It does not mean that whole program will be compiled and then you will get the errors and all. It means at the second line, if the error will be there, third line of the program is not going to proceed, right? Either you can say if you have written certain statement in the second line, third line, and if some mistake you have made at the second line, third line will not be read until and unless second line statement will be made corrected, right? So those things need to be very much clear while going for any programming language. So initially you can easily type in your terminal Python, so it will open you and prompt you to the Python interpreter, right? So basic thing that you can start with, how to print something on your keyboard, on your display, right? So suppose if you have to print say, like hello world in Python. So if anyone of you have tried Python before this, you will be able to understand that what is the difference between Python 2.x and Python 3.x. So very simple, it is like giving me hello world in Python, right? So what does this mean? That I written something inside print and the same statement is getting printed. So it just used to display something, right, in Python, a print statement. Like if you are familiar with C programming, you might have used printf. If you are familiar with JavaScript, you might have written console.log, right? If you are familiar with Java, you might have written system.out.println. So in Python, it's very simple. Print, just you have to write. But why I want to stress here, because might be you got some code written by some person that is available in suppose 2.x version. So what are the basic things that you can interrelate between Python 2.x version and Python 3.x version? So Python 2.x version, once I talk about, there was the very basic things that once you are writing print statement, you don't have to use parentheses. But here parentheses become one of the important aspects. So like that, if you were in Python 2.x, so it directly you can write like this. It was like Python 2.x syntax, but here you can see it is throwing error, right? Syntax error, missing parenthesis in call to print. Did you mean print hello world in Python? It is telling you that you are missing the parenthesis. So 2.x version was that you don't require parenthesis to be used, while in Python 3.x it is mandatory, right? So these are very basic things that we need to understand while moving from Python 2.x to Python 3.x version development. So this is very basic things. All of you must remember it while if you find any code. So basic errors that you will find to moving from 2.x to 3.x, this is going to be the very common error, right? So this way you can use interpreter. So time is very less. We directly move to the writing programs and how you can run Python as any script. So both the things we will see. So to come out of the terminal, you need to type exit and then parenthesis. So automatically you will be able to, close this particular Python interpreter. So I will be using basically here. So I will be using basically here Visual Studio Code, but you can go with any particular editor. Like suppose for you have Nano, right? So Nano by default is installed if you don't have now Visual Studio Code. So you can easily write your first basic program that what I printed using like how you can run it as a program, right? So something that I was doing that I was doing in interpreter. So like say hello world dot py, very basic program you want to write. So just you need to write something that you written print. Hello world in Python. right, and then double quote, and then you want to add one more line, you can add like print, this is my first program, right? And then if you are using nano editor, this is the most simplest one you can use in Ubuntu. So to save this, you can use Control O and then enter and then Control X to come out of this, right? So your program is there now. If you will do ls, you will find that helloworld.py is there. So you can easily run this using Python 3 helloworld.py, right? So you need to give Python 3, that is the interpreter, right? And helloworld.py, right? So easily it will display the output of the statement you written in that particular program file, right? So this is like you are running this particular Python file as a program, but Python is also used in scripting language. And this is very important once you are doing it in going for some automation kind of a script. So you need to run it as an script. So how you can run a Python program as an script? So let me tell you that particular part also in the same program that I am running as a Python program, how I can run it as a script. So let me make some changes in this program only. So what need to be write? First, you need to be write the cbind has exclamation, then where your interpreter lies, right? So /python3, okay? So generally your interpreter write inside binary. So inside your bin particular folder, and then there Python 3 is the interpreter, right? And then you need to find it out, give the read, write and executable permission. So that's why I'm giving 700 and only to the user, right? So I'm just adding permission on this particular file, executable permission to this file. So here you can see what it is saying, bad interpreter. It means the problem is that it is not able to find the interpreter. Where is that location, right? So this might you find problems on different kind of environment. So you need to first check where is your Python 3, right? So here it is saying usr bin Python 3.6, usr bin Python 3.8. It means it is not inside bin folder. It is inside usr bin, right? So what need to be changed here in this program? You need to add this line. Right, so now you can see, you don't even have to write the Python 3 particular, command. Directly you can run it as an script. So this way you can also, demonstrate that Python can be run as an script also. So this is very important thing that Python plays a vital role as an scripting language. So that's why even in VLSI industry, people are now started preferring Python over languages like Perl and Bash, right? So this is one important reason. So this way you can run Python program as an script, just you need to add this cbind, or you can say the Python interpreter path. And then more important, if I add a comment, right? So generally how to add comment in Python file, you need to use has. So has means that particular line is not executed by the interpreter. So that is, termed as comment. So you can see here, if I will add has, so it will not be treated as a statement. It will be treated as a comment, right? So here, if I write like running Python as a script, right? So this will be treated as a comment. So even if you will write now print this, so you can see that particular line is ignored by the Python interpreter, right? So you can write comment like this. So one important thing also need to be remembered while working with Python program is that Python does not support multi-line comments, right? So if you are very much familiar with the C programming languages or Java that support multi-line comments, Python doesn't have any support for multi-line. However, in coming few minutes, we are going to discuss about strings and all. So there is one thing that that you can use if you want to write multi-line comments. Like there is something called triple quotes in Python. Right. So there is a way also to declare a string, single quote, double quote, and triple quote that we will be, I will be discussing in coming coming 10-15 minutes. So that way you can also write multi-line comments if you want to use for this, but this will be not treated as a comment. This line will be treated as a string, but suppose if you are not using anywhere for performing any operation, so it will be like, written in the program, but not used anywhere. So people prefer triple line, triple quote string to whatever they have written to understand this in future. So you can also use triple line if you are very much interested to understand ki how should I write multi-line comments, right? So this way you can use like Python is very popular language. We can run Python as a script as well, just need to add first line that I have written. This is known as cbang. In the first line and provide executable permission. For this you can use chmod command if you are in Linux environment, right? So this way you can write multi-line comments if you are interested, but this is not comment. Interpreter read it, but actually I am not using anywhere this string, so this will be like just written and not used anywhere, right? So it's just a placeholder somewhere. So this way you can write multi-line comment also. So this is a way to write multi-line comment. However, this is not a Python does not support multi-line comment, right? So this way you can use. So like if I will run this program, only we will get those two lines. So moving further, how we can go ahead. So basic things in any programming language is to understand the variables, how you can use variables, right? So next thing, now I'm going to use our integrated development environment. So like your integrated development environment, we can use Visual Studio Code. So whatever I have written there, you can also see here easily. So this is integrated development environment, Visual Studio Code, and it is quite practiced in the industry. So you have also option to use Visual Studio Code, and more important that why I prefer, because I always supports open source technologies and platforms. So this is one of the best thing about Visual Studio Code. You can use any programming language with this. It is not only like PyCharm only you can use Python. So you can also write program in Java, C, anywhere. So to add new file, so let us see how your variables are declared in Python, right? So Python, whenever you are writing any particular file, you need to understand that it need to be in .py extension, right? Like in C, you need to be have .c extension. If you are writing C++, right? So CPP and all these kind of Java .java. So here you need to write in .py extension. So basically, if I talk about variables in Python, major are like number, strings, right? That we play around while doing the operations in IoT.
So Bhupendra, there is one question related to, I think it's very related to VS Code. So perhaps you can answer that question now itself.
Okay, sir. So, okay, fine. So is there in chat window?
Yeah. So this is, could you provide a sequence of steps to do the same in Visual Studio? Are we supposed to start with new project?
Okay, fine. So is this, could you provide a sequence of steps to the same in Visual Studio? Are we supposed to start with a new project? Yes, see, one thing you can do here, if you will initially start, it will come like this, right? Suppose I'm starting it. Let me go from the scratch. So if you will write code dot, right? So automatically it will take you like this welcome page, right? 1 minute. this welcome page will appear, right? So you can close it here, and here you can go to the file, and automatically what in wherever you will launch this Visual Studio Code, it will automatically get synced to the directory. Directory directory is there, right? So there first you need to create a new file, right? So new file, if you will type here, like say variables dot py, right? So that particular folder will get synced. So either you can here open particular file, open folder, open workspace if you have already created some folder. This is one more option, and I am coming to that also. So one option is that if you have created any particular folder, you can open there also, right? For example, this Python programming folder, right? And if I will click OK, this will open this Python programming folder, right? So on this Python programming folder, I can create new files. Either I can create new folder. So first thing is that I will create a new file, right? So here in that folder, I am creating variables dot py. Say like it is saying it is existing. So I created like this. So automatically this particular window will be appear. Here you can write your program, right? So this is very basic step. If you have Visual Studio installed, you can open directly a folder. Either you can do one thing. You can open your terminal like this. So suppose I am here in Python programming folder, right? By default. So if I will type code dot, it means I am asking my Visual Studio to be opened in this current folder, right? So this way, automatically Python programming folder will get sync with this particular workspace, right? That we say it workspace. So this is one option that you can use. And then here you can come on this particular folder and then you can create new file, right? So this is very basic step. I hope things will be now clear at your end.
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. So otherwise, if you people don't have, you can, you know, start practicing with the Nano Editor, right? That is also a good option. But what happens that time you need to look at indentation and all that side. So basic, let us be start with the numbers, right? So first thing that I mentioned already that Python programming is a dynamic type language, right? Okay, okay, no problem. If you are on Windows, then well and good if you can go with this. So if I talk about variables, right? So generally, if you have familiar with the static type languages where we need to define data types, like it's an integer data type, it's float data type, it's long, it's a string. But here once we come to the Python, right? Python is a dynamic type language. It means at the runtime, interpreter decides that it's an integer or it's a float. So we don't have to take care of that part. That is a good thing also in Python that your codes that are written in 20 lines in a static type language, here you can write in 10 lines or 5 lines, right? So like say I written num is equal to 5, right? And if you will try to print this value, say like print value of num is, right? And then you type num, say, okay. And there is a function called type. With that, you can check that whatever the type this variable num is going to be, you know, going to hold. So you can use like print. Variable num is type of okay, and then here you can easily write like type function. This is inbuilt function, and here you can type num. So now if you want to run this program, there are two options, right? One is terminal is there, so you can directly open your terminal here like this in Visual Studio Code only. And if you are using like, for example, your Nano Editor like that, so from there you can also run this program, say like Python okay. So Here you can directly run this program from this terminal also, like this, right? Value of num is 5. Variable num is type of class int. So basically in Python everything is dependent over class and object, because Python is object oriented type language. So due to very less time constraint, we will not be able to touch that particular part. But just understand everything in Python is treated as object and class. So if you are familiar with OOPs programming languages, you can understand that particular part also. So it's an integer type, right? So we are not, defining this particular variable explicitly that int x is equal to 5. So automatically my interpreter is deciding that this particular variable is integer type or float type, right? Either second option is that from here only you can run this program like Python 3 and then variables 1.py, right? So automatically this program is running. So say let us go into the file that I created, say variables.py, and I written like num 1 is equal to 3.5, right? And then if I will try to print type of num 1, right? So if I will go with this, say like variables.py, so here like it is saying, see, sometime if you will get like this error, it is saying syntax error, unexpected UF while parsing. So why this error was coming? Because I forget to add one more parenthesis, right? So in any programming language, we need to understand the errors very properly, right? Why these particular errors are coming. So here was that I was missing parenthesis, right? So if I will run this program, variables.py, so it is saying class float. It means the data type of this num1 is float. We don't have to, define explicitly. So we can go ahead and let's play with some strings, right? So more important while we deal with the string. So strings you can write in single quote, you can write in double quote, and you can write triple quote if you are dealing with multi-line, right? That's what I told. And easily you can perform the operations on your string, right? So a string is nothing but its collection of characters, right? Say for example, if I want to type anything, say institute name, right? Institute name equal to say IIT Goa, right? So this is a string, right? Because this is nothing but collection of characters, and there are 6 characters involved into it, and adding the space is also treated as character. So there are 7 characters into it, right? So anyway, you can also write like program name. So here you can write like FTP, single quote, right? So you can also test FTP, right? So this is nothing but a string, right? And if you want to print this, you can easily go with this something called print, okay? So print means what? Again, I am explaining, because most of you, if you have doubt, print means anything, any variable that particular is containing some value, right? Like institute name has a value IIT Goa and program name has some value FTP, right? So these are nothing but the variables. You can change these variables later on also. So print basically do what? Whatever I have the variable value, it will be printing on my console or on my display, right? So if I will write print here, right? And print, so like for example, name of the institute, right? Name of the institute, right? And then double quote you need to close. So this is like initial message that you want to display. And then you need to write the variable name, comma, and here this is institute name, right? Institute name. This is the benefit of using integrated development environment. You don't have to type the whole, syntax again. So this is the benefit of this. And then you can print like program name and then here you can write program name. And suppose you want to check the type of these variables, right? So you can easily print using type function, if you can recall, right? So institute type, if I try to print, right? So here what I will write, type function. Okay, in type function we can easily write your institute name. It means inside this what I will write, variable name of that particular thing, right? And then if you want to print this program name, so same thing you can write like this. Here you can write program type, and then remember this, just we need to inside the type function we have to pass the variable name of program name, right? So once you will now run this program, Python 3 variables dot py, here you can see name of the institute IIT Goa that we printed, right? And program name is FDP, faculty development program. And then program type, you are able to see string, right? And if you are typing institute type, you are also getting string. It means it doesn't matter you are using double quote or single quote. While if you are dealing with other languages, their double quote and single quote means different things. And let us see also this triple quote, right? That is preferably used for your, you know, multi-line comments also. But suppose you want to write like this, say name, say like book list equal to, right? And you can use multi-line comment. Multi-line here. Book list is going to say IoT for architects. Right, and then you can use for like wireless sensor networks. Right, and then you want to close it, then you can use this particular triple quote. And then you can print this particular using like print book list and don't forget to use double quote, right? And then comma variable name, right? So if you will now, I'll try to run this program, Python 3 variables dot py. What I am getting here, book list, right? And if you want to ensure that what is the type of this, you can easily print type of book list is, right? So here you can pass type function, and inside that you can easily pass the variable name, that is book list. And now if you will run this program, you can see string, right? So there are three ways which you can use to, you know, define your string types. So you can also use single quote, you can also use double quote, and you can also use triple quote, depending on your, you know, understanding. So it's a one of the best thing that is available in Python. You can use single quote, double quote, and if you are using very, if you are, you love poetry, right? So you can easily write your poetry using triple quotes, right? So these are very basic things that will require to write your program in Python using the variable. One, you have to deal with the strings, either you have to deal with the numbers, right? So in numbers, two important thing, either your sensor data could be a float, either it could be a integer, right? Temperature value is 17 degrees centigrade or 17.2 degrees centigrade. So basically you have to deal with this. And then might be want to write sensor names, say like DHT11, DHT22, these are temperature and humidity sensors. Either you want to write MLX90614 for your like measuring the body temperature, right? So these are the sensor model numbers. So that way you can use like a string, right? So these two major variables that are going to come handy while you writing very basic Python applications, right? On Raspberry Pi or any particular aligned application boards. So next thing, once you are done with this very basic variables like a string and numbers, right? So one important thing that will be coming in your mind, that how to use the formats, right? like in Python and in C, if you have done some little bit programming, in C programming you have format specify like percentage D, percentage S, percentage C, percentage, you know, F for float, like this. But how I can use in Python that way, right? So let me give you one example also of how you can use formats, right? So let me create a new particular file, say in Python programming, I can create one more file. Say here I am creating a files. You can give any name, say like str underscore format dot py, right? So don't forget to add .py extension, right? Because this is very important. It tells the system that this particular program is going to be used as a Python program, right? So for example, I want to write something, say like age is equal to 25, right? And name is equal to, say, John, right? So there are two particular variables. One is a string, one is integer, right? 25 and this. And I want to print this in a format like John is 25 years old, something like that, right? So we need to use something called format, that we don't require any particular hard coded. Either we should write John is 25 years old, either we should use like these variables, and we should place these variables at that particular location. So these name will be keep changing, right? John, in place of John, it could be like any name, right? Like Ram, Sam, anything, it could be there, right? So in that way, you have to use some format specifier. So for that, you can write like this, say like print. And then more important, indexing is very important, right? So say if I write like print, okay? And you can write like in double curly braces will be used. In curly braces, you can write like zero, okay? Zero means first one. It means here whatever you want to print, say like John or 25, it depends, but you need to write like this. And then if you want like something years old, something like that, or he's this particular age right now. So some statement I want to write like John was 25 years old. So what I will write? $0. So here name will come later, and then you want to write 25 years old. So age will come next, right? So it means I need to give one more placeholder. So that is one, right? It's the zeroth index and first index, right? So here I written old, right? When he started his IoT journey, for example. Okay, so this is very important. Now what next? We need to use comma. Right? No. Comma be used whenever we are not using this particular format. Here we need to complete this statement, and then there is some function called format dot format, right? And here you need to again give the precedence like 0, 1. So which one will come? 0. At 0 you need to come name, right? Name, and then here you have to write age, right? Now at 0th place, your name will come, whatever name will be here, like here John. And then at one place, it will come age. Fine. So let us run this program and see what actually it is displaying. So nothing is coming. Python 3 str format dot py. Why? So I have written print here, right? I also written like $John, 1 year old. So actually in Visual Studio Code, what happens, sometimes we don't save this code, right? So here you will see bubble. So now I have saved this code, that's why. So might be you will be finding this if you are using first time. That's why I shown that sometimes your program is not saved. So you need to check here. Like suppose some line I added print. So here you can see this white, bubble. It means my program is not saved, right? So if you are using first time Visual Studio Code, you need to always do Control S. So now if I will run this program, Python 3 str format dot py, it will say John. It means at 0th place, this name variable has taken the space here, name, right? John was 25 is coming at this place, this, because age is written here. 25 years old when he started his IoT journey. So this way you can use, if you are very much, you know, love doing formatting your code, and also you can use format function. This is one of the best thing available, right? So this way you can use format function. So next important aspect after this, if you are clear with this, we should move ahead with the something called control flow, how you can write if else statements, right, in Python, and how those things comes handy, because you need to write those conditions dealing with the IoT application. Like for example, if your temperature is beyond 25 degrees, then turn on your AC. It means you need to write certain control flows, if else statement. So this is basic variables, string and numbers. In number, you deal with the float and this particular called integer. And then in string, you can write single quote, double quote, triple quote. And also you can use till now format, how you can use this format function, right? So moving ahead, let's try to use our control flow. So I'm not going on operators and all like greater than, less than, equal to, because time is very less. So we need to touch down the core part. But I'll at least help you out that how you can get the right materials related to your Python, right? And then you can start practicing if you want more in details. So let's create one more new file and try to create some, click on plus, and then it will ask you to, for example, if I want to go with the if statement, right? So if else statement. So let us start with this very basic statement. So like if statement.py, if I have created this particular Python file, right? So say I want to play any guess game, right? For example, let us take number, some number is equal to 27, right? And I want to introduce one more concept here. Like for example, if you have you deal within C programming and all, right? So you use printf statement and scanf statement to take input and store somewhere, right, in your variable, and then those variables can be used in further in your applications. It means you want to take input from the standard input, that is, it means std in your keyboard and all, right? So here you have int function, input function for that. So here, say like I want to write guess, okay, guess equal to what? Anything, any number that he will enter, like say 25, 22, 23. So this is one more new variable, right? That whatever value will be entered by the user, that will be getting, going to be stored in this guess variable. Then we need to write input function, right? Input inside this, whatever you will write, this will prompt on your, std out. It means on your terminal to enter from the user. So I'm writing like enter an integer. Okay, so I am taking this and I will use this particular function input, right? So input enter an integer, right? But by default, one thing is very important to understand, input function by default take a string, anything whatever will enter, input function will take it as a string. By default store any value as a string, right? So it means we need type costing of it. For example, here if I am, want to understand what is the type of this case. So let us, before moving to the exact if statement, let us test it, print type. And here I can say like case, right? So if I will run this program, Python 3 and if statement.py. So here it is asking enter an integer. Say if you are entering 12, but what you are getting, class string. It means by default, it is taking it as a string, but requirement is of integer, right? So what does this mean? You need to do type casting of it. So I am now converting explicitly into the Python integer, right? So now I have added integer type of this. So now if I will run this program and if I will type 12, it is saying int. It means now I have done the type casting here, right? So my cost from string is changed to the integer now, right? So this line I will comment now. So to make sure that you should convert into the integer, right? So number is now 27, for example, by default I have taken, and I want to compare it, right? If number entered by the user is 27, then it means congratulations, he has guessed that particular number correctly, right? So what we need to write? I need to write control statement called if. So if guess double equal to, right? You want to compare it, number. Now here the exact, you know, problem in Python arrives. Python actually is nothing like if you have done in C programming like this and Java and all programming languages. So there is nothing like this, something called curly braces. So, you know, tell that this is the block of the program that belongs to this if statement. No, there is nothing like that. So in this, you need to use the parenthesis. Indentation method. So for that, if you will write, you need to write column here, and then because this is integrated development environment, it has added some particular spaces to it. But if you are using any particular, you know, text editor, by default it will not do for you, right? So what you can do there, you can maintain the same space that you are writing from this particular line. So that particular line will belong to this if block, right? So if you are taking two space, so maintain two space, writing all the statement that need to belong to this if statement. That is very important, right? So if I say here, so I will say like new block will start from here. So this belong to if only, right? So if your guess, if he enters 27 and that number is 27 that I have already declared, so I can say like print, okay? Some message I want to display, say like congratulations, you guessed it. Are you guessed it correctly, right? Whatever you mean to say here, some message you want to display, right? So that you can print here. But of course, we don't have any money to give him, so you can also add some line, right, like print. But I have only appreciation for you. Okay, so one important aspect, because more of you will be here from the faculty side. So as of my journey in 3-4 years during this, you know, training, one thing I found, the much you will make your, you know, training fun to the student, they will find it very, you know, interactive. While if you will make it boring, like you are making statements and they will not understand. So it becomes very difficult for the student to programming to understand, because in IoT domain, many times you will find the people will be coming from electronics background. Maybe they are interested coming from mechanical background, but programming become must. So you should starting time, you should make it like these kind of things. So they should find it interesting. Okay, I'm writing this. Don't go by like initially only very hard statements and very hard logic, very basic logic you should tell them, so that they should get familiar with the programming languages, and then they can, you know, you can go by base, logic building and all that things. So now, if your this particular if block is over, right? Next important aspect is that you need to come out of this loop, right? So just once your particular statement is over, now start from the same line, right? Where you have written if. So here, nothing is called else if. Like if you have used C programming language, there will be else if. Here we use elif, right? Elif. So in elif, I want to write like say, here also, this is not required. Suppose I'm just adding one, you know, syntax burden on it. That will occupy the space. You can write like this also directly without adding parentheses. Elif, I want to write like if guess less than number, right? Then I want to print something, say like print no. So you want to say something like print no and guess less than number, right? It means your number is less than the guess, whatever he has entered. Say for example, he has entered 15. So it means he is very much closer to that number, but he's not got the correct number, right? So you can print like no It is not. You should try to enter little more higher number. This way you can print something like this, right? Either the third condition could be like, if either it is equal to, either it could be less than, either it could be greater than, right? So you can directly write else statement, right? Come out of this loop and write else statement. So no need to write specifically, because only three things may be: either it's greater than, either equal to, either it could be less than, right? So third statement else by default, and you can print, if you have entered higher, so you can print, no, it's not, you should try to enter little more lesser number, right? So this way you can write basic if, elif and else statement, right? So it's very easy if you have done any programming language before that. And if you want to say like something, you know, other, any other thing you want to print, so outside this loop you can directly print this, like print, if you want to add some more message, so you can print, okay, have a nice day, for example, you want to print, right? Once you have done with this game, have a nice day, well played. This way you can print some more statement, right? So let us try to run this program. So if I will write like Python 3 if statement dot py, right? So it is throwing some error right here at else. Else it is saying syntax error, invalid syntax in else, right? So what is that error? Now I written it, you know, a statement knowingly, so that in future if you find these errors, how you will rectify, right? Else. So always remember, while you are writing any block, even there is no statement, you need to write colon. Now if I will run this program, automatically this program will run. So I will also tell you this same approach whenever you are, you know, going into the training or any pair. First tell the students to understand the errors. So next time, once they will write the program, because I have little bit less time, that's why I cannot touch all the spectrums. But I will always encourage, every time you should make some error, so that in a programming, the best thing is that you must understand the error, why this is coming. So next time, once you will be trying to do the programming and it is a very large code, like say 150 lines, 200 lines, then you will be easily able to figure out, okay, this could be the error, right? So for example, going to the logic, if I will enter say like 25, right? So it is saying this guess is like whatever the number, 27 is less than. So it is saying, no, it's not. You should try to enter a little more higher number, right? So elif statement, it is getting printed because our number, the number that I have entered, guess number, right? It's 25. So this is less than the number that I have assumed, 27, right? So this block. And by default, my last statement will get printed. Now, if I will run again, and if I will enter 27, right? So each one is getting printed this statement. So it is first statement. So here it is trying to print guess is equal to number. And if this statement is true, this block of code will be executed. If this statement is, if this particular expression is true, this block of statement will be printed. Either in this block, whatever statement is written, printed, and the last one will, of course, because this need to be printed because it's outside the bounding condition. So if the third condition, if I want to test it, say like if I will enter 40, right? So you can see this particular else block is getting executed. No, it's not. You should try to enter little more or less a number, right? So this way you can write your if, else if, and elif blocks.
Suppose you want to repeat it till you get it right, then what changes will you make?
So you can write while loop, right? While you can continuously check it, right? So on the top of that, you can write while loop, while true, right? So it will be continuously asking from here, right? You can just write while true. That's it. So this will be while loop, right? So it will be but one thing that again, we need to do the everything indentation will be important. Again, we need to change the whole program. Just you need to change the logic. That's it. So it will be continuously asking, right? Say I enter 25. Then again, it will ask 27, 22. And if you want, like once he entered the correct number, right, 27, and you want to come out of this loop, so you need to add break. So say if I will close this program, so he entered 27, right? Automatically your program is coming out of the loop. And until and unless it is not correcting the guess number, right? So what you can do? You can continuously ask the user to enter, say like 25. So again, that particular loop will come, say 40, right? And once he entered the correct, automatically your program get closed because you have used break, right? So this way you can write. I think this was your query, right?
Yeah.
So this way you can execute while loop is there. So you can continuously.
So it's basically instead of braces, it's the indentation which plays the role of braces. You have to
correct. So a little bit, if you will find problem in Python, is this one only. Other than everything is very easy and fantastic. But a whole program need to be indented, right? So this is important thing. Otherwise, it will throw error. For example, if I will write elif like this, right? So it will throw error. It is saying like invalid syntax. So it need to be properly indented. So it's good now we have used while statement also. So this way you can use while statement, right? It will be continuously running. So it's good that both the things, and break statement is used to come out from any particular loop, right? So break is also getting used in this. So multiple things get used in one program. So it's good also, right? So next thing that we will touch down. Now, how you can use like something called functions, right? Because functions are very important part of any particular programming language where you want to use that particular code multiple times in a program, right? So it means this is the function is nothing but a, you know, the piece of code that is written that can be, you know, reused multiple times in a program. So that's it. Function is very simple thing. So let us see how we can write functions in Python. Okay. So in this particular language Python, functions is so easy to write as compared to any other programming language. So let's see how we can write that particular part. So let us create like say function demo.py. So the syntax is very simple, right? What is syntax? If I write the syntax for this, so you need to write def and then function underscore name, right? And then colon, and then inside this your statements will come. Statements will come, and then if you have to call this function, you need to just write the function name. That's it. Automatically your function will be called. So let us try this, writing a very simple function, say def, say hello, right? So def is mandatory. This is the keyword that need to be put up before the function name, and then colon, right? And you can write some statement here like say print hello world in Python, right? So your statement. Now how this function will be called, just need to first remember this function name should be outside the function loop, right? So here this I have written this particular statement inside the function loop, and then I have to come out of this loop and write the function name, and then parenthesis. This is very important thing. And let us try, if you have not forget it, how to use it as an script. So let us try, so that slash usr slash bin slash Python 3, okay? And I want to keep the read, write and executable permission to this file dot slash function demo dot py. So you can see here, hello world in Python. So this is very basic, you know, way of writing a function. And if you will call this particular function again, it is going to print that statement twice. It means this statement written hello world in Python will be printed here two times because I am calling this function two times. Hello world in Python, hello world in Python. So we don't have to write, this is a benefit of function. We don't have to write print twice. We have to just call this particular function, right? So this is one particular important part that you should, you know, practice. Let us try to use, how to pass the arguments in the function. That is one of the important things. So this is very basic way. Let us try to write one more function program to understand it more. Function underscore demo 1.py. Okay, so let us write, say I want to print, maximum between two numbers. Okay, so say like def print say max, right? So if any number I am giving 10 and 15, so it should print the whatever the maximum number in between that it is. It means 15 it should print, right? So I have written def and function name, and say I am taking, here two particular variables, say num1 comma num2, right? By default, you need to pass these arguments. This is called as function argument, num1 and num2. These are two particular arguments. Inside this, we need to now write the if statement. If num1 greater than num2, right? So here you can print num1, right? And then is greatest. Either second thing could be what? Elif. Okay, elif what will be there? num1 equal to num2, right? And then you can print num1, right? It is equal to num2, right? So num1 comma is equal to, right, and then you can use num2, and then you can write else, right? Of course else less than condition is remaining, so you can write print num2 is greatest. Very simple, right? Now your function logical part is over, right? Num2 is greatest. Either you can write like num2 is maximum. Now how to call this function, right? So you have two options. Either you can pass these values as a hard code, say like I am passing 10, right? Fine. So by default 10 will assign to num1 and 20 will assign to num2, right? So it means we have to pass those values. So num1 will be assigned as 10 and num2 will be assigned as 20. So let us run this program, right? Python 3 function underscore demo 1.py, right? So it is saying 20 is maximum, but it is hard coded, right? So second option, all of you know now, you can use like say
input
function, right? So you can use input function also, you have this option, right? Input you can use. So that is one way you can use input function, right? So we have only 10 minutes, so I just want to touch down other concept. So, but you can use, because we have already to, given somewhere like this. In somewhere I written input function, right? So that way you can write your input function here, like say x is equal to input, right? Like this you can write. And then ensure that your input must be integer, like this, okay? So x is equal to input, and here you can write like enter number 1. We have 10 minutes. Okay, let us go. So this way you can also write x is equal to enter number 1, right? but ensure that it must be typecasted into integer. I have already explained that why you need to typecast it, because by default your input function take it as a and here a string, right? So int enter number 2, right? And here by default you can call this function, and here you can pass x and y. So whatever value will be entered by the user, it will be getting printed here. For example, if I will call this function, so it is asking say 25. So second statement is getting executed, 25 is equal to 25. Right, if I say 15, 10, right? So 15 is maximum. It means first statement is getting executed. While if I will enter 10, 15, so it is saying 15 is maximum. So this statement is getting executed, right?
Okay, one question, should the function always be defined before the call?
This one.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, like, yes, because if you will write this function on the top of it, it will doesn't find print max, right?
Okay.
Because it's interpreted language. So first statement will start from here, right? So if you will write like this, right, let us try this also. Okay, so their doubt will be clear. So what error it will throw? It is saying print max is not defined, name error, because here it is not able to understand what is print max, right? So because this is interpreted language, so my code is getting halted at the first statement only. That's why we cannot, you know, write the function on the top. Like the other languages we do in, you know, C programming and all. So it need to be written after this only. So let us touch down some more particular, you know, things that are available as a data container. So let's start with the list first. So there is one more function type. If you go more on the like data science side and also, there is called lambda function. You can note down somewhere and you can look at it how that particular thing is written. Lambda function, right? So let's start with some these things are known as data structures in Python, right? Because they hold data in some structured way, some sequences way, right? So list is basically a very basic data structure in Python where you can, you know, keep the list of some particular item. For example, if you want to keep the list of the sensors, you want to keep the list of some fruits, and list basically takes any kind of data types you can store in this, right? For example, if I take, let's say, like a sensor list, right? So you need to write the variable name and then equal to sign. And then very important is to understand how to fit, declare those variables or initialize those variables inside this list. You need to use the square bracket. Square bracket gives you the identity that this is going to be the list type, right? Because next we will be going for something else. So then you will find it out easily at the first sight only that you will be able to distinguish without, using type or any particular function. So let us create a list of, mix item. Say I want to keep some fruits, so I written like banana, and I also want to, you know, put some numbers into it, say 1, 1.5, right? And some other types, say like boolean, true, right? So this way you can create list and you can print sensor underscore list. So if I have to run this particular thing, say like Python 3, list demo.py, right? So this list is getting printed. So how I can iterate this? First, I want only banana from this list, right? So you can use index. So this is 0th index, first index, second index, and third index, right? So you just need to write print name of the variable, what is that? Sensor list, and then indexes need to be mentioned inside this particular something called square bracket. So if I will write 1, I will get this 1. If I will write 0, I will get the first index, 0, first, 1, 2. So it's very much similar to the array that we use in C programming and all. Arrays are also there, but array are only, you know, restricted to the one data type. But list is something where you can, you know, keep any kind of data type. So if I will now run, so I'm getting banana right here, sensor list dot zero. Either better keep some, you know, name like mix list. It will make more sense because there is no sensor in this. Okay, and suppose you want to make the sensor list, right? So you can keep it like sensor list equal to DHT11, then MLX90614. Right, and you can also use HCSR04. These are some sensor model, like this is, for example, used for your ultrasonic sensor. So you can also print using negative index. Python also support negative indexing, right? So suppose I want last digit, so you can use -1. So -1 will print the last value of this particular list, HCSR04. And -1, -2, -3, it goes like this. So here you can see HCSR04. If I change this value to -3, it will print the DHT11, right? So the negative indexing is also supported in Python. -1, -2, -3. So it is start at the last element. It is start from -1, then -2 and -3. So this way you can also print. It means -3 is equal to the zeroth index in positive indexing. So both the statement will print DHT11. So Python support both the indexing type. It also support, you know, this particular negative indexing and positive indexing both. So this is one of the important thing. Second important aspect is how you can use these particular, you know, if you want to print one by one. So iteration, how we'll do iteration. So you have for loop. So in for loop, your Python is little bit different from other languages where you like for x is equal to 0, x less than 3, x plus plus, right? And then you write inside that. Here basically is very simple. Automatically you can write like for item in sensor list. Automatically it will do iteration. For item in sensor list, and I want to print what? Item. So if you will pass this, it will iterate one by one. It means first it will print DHT11, MLX and HCSR04. Like this, one iteration, right? So you can put some message here, print items in the list are, and it will go by this. So you can see here, right? So this will do the iteration one by one. It means by default it do the iteration, you don't have to do anything here, right? So this is called list. So let us understand list. It means one important aspect is in list that you can, you know, change any particular value later on. For example, I want to update banana to say mango, right? Either I want to, you know, update the sensor value to DHT22. So easily you can do it like sensor list equal to, just we need to write the index number. Sensor list of 0, I want to update it to the DHT22. It will overwrite that value, right? So now, if I will iterate the item, after updating the list, so here you can see DHT22 has been, you know, introduced. It means I can update the list easily, right? But there could be cases where you don't want any particular thing to be replaced. It means in between, if some person is trying to update any item of that particular, you know, a container where you have put up all those values, so it should not get updated, right? That particular important thing, if you are looking for example, you have created some sensor list, and you don't want that particular sensor list be updated in future, right? So there is one more data structure in Python called tuples. So basically, there are two types of data structures or data types in Python. One is called, mutable types. One is called immutable types. So list is mutable. Mutable means we can go on some particular index and we can change that value. While if I talk about immutable data structure or data type, you cannot change the value. So the next one is tuple. We have something called tuple in this. So let me create a particular file for this. Say like tuple demo.py, right? So let's go with this only. Say what I have created here, say sensor list this, right? If I go with this in this tuple demo, so what basically get changed here? Tuples are basically, the values inside tuples are stored inside parentheses, right? So this will tell that this is tuple. You can also print for your, knowledge. You must print it, like if you have any confusion to see. So if I will run this program, Python 3 tuple demo, why nothing is coming? Because I have not written print statement, right? So if I will write here print statement, and if I will run this program, right? So here you can see class tuple. And if you will go in list, and if you will try to print something called print type sensor list, right? And if I will run that program that I have done, right? List demo.py. Here you can see class list. So this is list type and this is tuple type. So the difference between tuple and list is more important. At the first line, if I write a couple, tuples are immutable. Immutable in nature. It means anything that you created initially, you cannot change it. So here now, if I will try to print some this particular sensor list that I have created, right? So I can print, I can use for loop, same here, for item in sensor underscore list, print sensor list, right? So these tuples are getting printed thrice because it is taking a single state value at a time, right? One by one, it is iterating this. Okay, so here it means they cannot be changed. While in list, it was taking 1, 1, 1, right? Because it consider this particular thing as a one particular, variable, right? But let us understand one more important aspect here. To check that I am able to change this value or not, DHT11, I want to change this value. So then you will understand that it is immutable in nature. So what I will do, I will write sensor list and I will write the index number here, right? And I will change this value to DHT22, say, right? Now, if I will try to run this program, what it will throw? Here you see, trace back most recent call last, right? Okay, file tuple demo.py sensor list 0. Tuple object does not support item assignment. It means you cannot change any particular value that has been written inside a tuple in later stage. So you must use the tuples where you want that. In if any new programmer is joining in your industry and he is doing the program and he want to add something without asking to you, of course you can keep it as a tuple, right? So this way you can use tuple in those particular application where you want your value must not change. So this error is, that's why it is coming. And this is output is coming because it's interpreted language. So it means till here things are going fine and it is your program is getting stuck this. So I'm commenting this line. So this will throw error, right? Why reason is that?
Excuse me, can I add the new index or instead of changing the DHT11, if I add in the index position zero I can add?
No. Nothing you can add. Initially, whatever it is created, this will be remain same. You mean to say like sensor list dot append, suppose you want to append some value, right? So open it does not support append also. Like say I want to add DHT22 as a last here after SCSR04, right? It will also throw error. While the same function will work easily in list. Reason is that whatever you have created at a time, this cannot be changed at the later stage. This is the benefit of tuple. I think this was the question, something like that.
That is what my question. Thank you.
It means you cannot use at the later stage also, right? It means at the fourth index, you cannot. While you can do append operation with list easily, right? This is the benefit of tuple. The last one in the this series is dictionary. That is very important part while dealing with operations like IoT, because mostly your operations are going to be like there will be 2-3 kind of keys involved into one particular sensor. For example, DHT22 or DHT11 sensor, if you are using, it provides you two particular values from that sensor. One is like temperature and one is called humidity. It means there is a key, there is a value. So you might have some of you, if you are working previously in IoT domain, you have written certain program related to, in JavaScript or something, or you might be familiar with a data exchange format called JSON, JavaScript object notation, where everything is written in key value format, right? So in Python, for JSON kind of structure is there something called dictionary, right? So let us see how that particular thing is works. Dictionary demo.py. So dictionary is nothing but it's a key value pair, right? Dictionary is nothing but key value pair for storing the right. So you just need to create a variable, say like sensor data. Say let us go with the sensor data, right? So in sensor data, sensor called DHT22. So we have two parameters, say like temperature and humidity, right? So how I will be going to work with that? So for dictionary, you need to use curly braces. While for list, you need to use a square bracket, and for tuples, you need to use parentheses, right? So first we need to write the key. Key is like, for example, here temperature, 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 right? temperature, temperature. Temperature you want to say like 27. So value is integer, right? So your value will be like this, and then comma. So this is your first key value pair. So it can contain multiple key value pair, right? So I want to write humidity. So humidity is the string. Key should be unique, that is very important, right? Either it will create problem later on. So humidity here, humidity you can write, let's say like 96, and then you want to write, say like place. So say like place Goa, right? I assume that Goa doesn't, humidity will be less. Pune, of course, 1996. So this way you can write. So here temperature is key, humidity is key, and your place is key, and these are the values, right? Goa must be string, right? So this is, so if you want to print this particular value, right, temperature only from this, so you can easily use print statement. And inside this, you need to write like print sensor data. And inside this, you just need to pass the key name. Okay. By default, it will print the value. Python 3 dictionary. Okay, 27, right? So you can easily access the value of any particular key of this particular dictionary using this particular thing called keys. You want to only get humidity, right? So you just need to pass here humidity, right? So it will print the humidity. If okay, so S would be in capital, right? For example, you want to update this value later in this series, right? So what you need to write? You need to write sensor data, okay, like this. I want to update my temperature. So here you just need to write sensor data temperature equal to, say now change to 25. Okay, and now try to print this particular statement again. Now you will find that your temperature value has changed to 25. So suppose you are getting the real time values. So here in place of hard coding 25 or something like that, initially you can take these values as 00, right? And place Goa, you can take it as a static value, because place doesn't change wherever you are, you know, deploying your sensors. So in this case here, you need to just pass the API that you are using for, you know, fetching the data from the sensor. For example, if you are using DHT22, so you can write like DHT22.getTemperature, right? So automatically this value will get updated. So this way you can use dictionary if a particular sensor is providing multiple values, right? So this is very basic of Python that I have touched in this time span. Though Python is very wide language and it has, you know, enormous libraries and packages. So let's see at the last how we can, you know, import some package and we can, use that particular package in this. So tomorrow I have to, conduct other sessions. So there you will get more clarity about, you know, Python, that how you can use into the real time applications. So if you have boards like Raspberry Pi and all, you can, you know, carry out for your practical applications. If you want to do practice at your home or something like that, right? So let us just finish it like, with something called your modules or packages, right? So by default in Python, the package that we use is called pip, right? So pip, today we will not demonstrate how we use to install like third party packages, because reason is that we have not written any applications where we can use this particular, package. But for example, I want this particular value to be printed after 1 and 2 seconds, because most of the time you will be dealing with the applications where your sensor needs some time for settling, right? Continuously without delay, if you are trying to print the values, it may throw error, because every sensor has some settling time for 1 second, yeah, 50 milliseconds, something like that is there, right? So you need to read the data sheet and to understand for that part. So in this same example, let me open one, create one particular file, say like package demo.py. So in this application, I want to, print these value temperature and humidity after every 2 seconds, right? So what I will use? I will use while loop first, because my sensor value need to become continuously, and I will use tab here, right? But I want that my sensor should get some time for settling, right? So I need to use some package for, using any particular inbuilt or third party package, we need to use a syntax called import. So like, for example, providing delay, we have some package called time, right? So if I will here give time dot sleep, right? So by default, your sleep function, take the value in seconds. So if I will get 2 here, so it means it will go for 2 second delay. So it will be continuously printing temperature and humidity value, but of course after every 2 seconds. So let us run this program, python3 package demo.py. So you can see 2796 and then 2 second delay, right? 27. So this way actually you expect some value to be coming from the sensors, right? After 2 second delay, 5 second or 1 minute, because generally in IoT applications your sensor value doesn't change frequently. It will never happen that in your room your temperature is changing 25, 26, 27. It means even if you are looking for the real time application, industry level applications, you need to provide, you know, significant delays to avoid overloading of your data on cloud and increase the cost. So this way we can use these kind of packages called time.sleep and all, right? So this is very basic of Python. So I will share all these codes and all with Saras sir. He will be sharing all these things with you all if you have not practiced. But again, I am saying this Python is not ended. This is just a very beginning, you know, of the Python. We need to understand some APIs and all. Tomorrow, while I will be discussing about MQTT protocol and all, I will give you the exact implementation, how your protocol implementation happens practically in Python and all. So it will give you the boost to up how exactly industry practices these Python languages in the core, you know, connecting your data to the cloud and getting some data from the sensors on Raspberry Pi boards and all. So you will get more clarity of this Python in wide spectrum as compared to the your today's session. So this was just to enable you to use Python in IoT context, but lot of things need to be explored further. You can use like little bit other packages like NumPy, Pandas, SciPy, Flask, Django if you are more interested to build your career. This is just core of Python. That's it. Oops concept, how to create class, how to create object, right? Then concepts of like polymorphism and inheritance, all those things you can practice later in this series. So from my side, now if there are any questions, sir, I am done with basic things.
Yes, I think that was quite good, especially the way you discussed list and tuple and dictionary with respect to, you know, sensor data, taking that as an example. That explanation was very nice. I think that would have helped our participants understand and appreciate those, why we have something called list, why we have something called tuple, why we have something called dictionary. So that is very nice. So there are a few questions for you. One is there a concept of pointer in Python?
No, there is nothing like pointer in this, but because everything here is object and all, right? So object related to object and class. So of course, there will be some memory related concept, but we don't have pointers in Python, specifically that you use in C or C++. So there is no concept of pointer in this.
Okay, so there is a related question, which I think, so the question is, can we pass references in Python functions like we do parameter, you know, passing by reference in C? So correct. Is there anything?
No, we don't have anything related to reference because here everything is object, right? So an object refers always to some particular memory, right? So whenever we pass any object or anything, it by default internally refers to some memory. So we don't have to deal related to like and X and Y that we do in like C programming. Nothing like that. It's like application level programming more into it, right? So you don't have to go much on memory level. So this is so easy. That's why Python become more popular for developer community.
Okay. There was one question in the very beginning. What are your thoughts about, you know, memory footprint of a Python program versus the memory footprint of a C program?
So of course, this is a very good question. So what I basically recommend you to, like at the lowest side, if people go even C and C, Python also uses C and C++ at the lowest implementation. So speed is one particular issue. If you are working more on hardware side, even I have tested some more applications. So your program will be a little bit slow, right? As compared to Python, because Python is more close to the hardware. While talking about, C and C++ is more closer to the hardware level, while Python is more on application level side, so speed could be one particular issue. But like in IoT and all, it works fine because you don't have to directly deal on the, you know, low level. Now, a lot of wrappers are written automatically like APIs. So that in the backend side, they write C++. So you don't have to take care. They take care of that side. So this is the benefit of, on the top of that, you have wrappers for that.
There is one more question. What are some other flexibilities which are not there in C++ but which exist in Python?
C++ is more restricted to your talk about like hardware side. You can only develop little bit desktop applications are like Qt based frameworks and all is there. Like, but if you have to extend cloud and all, there are very less SDK that are available in C++. If you have to apply data science concept, machine learning concept, data analytics in IoT, because they are very important part once your data is there, right? So Python has a lot of rich library. You want to develop any web applications. You don't want to use custom cloud platform, right? Build platforms. You want to create your own platform. So you have like Flask framework, Django framework, all these things you will not find in C++. So Python has very rich application to, enhance from your only edge device. Not only till edge device, you can go beyond cloud. You can add machine learning and everything in only one particular Python file. But in C++, you need to search a lot of libraries, JSON support, and all things. So it's very difficult in C++. But it's a lot of flexibility once you talk about in Python. Yes, there is something like, there is a question like set something in Python. It means we have set. Like you mean to say, if we have to, avoid duplication, right, in a particular variable, we have set. So you can look it out, very simple thing is the declaration of the set. So you can use set also if you want, like something, if there is any duplicated, like list and tuple, they can contain duplicate values, right? While if you will use set, they will not, contain duplicate values. So set could be the one benefit if you want to, avoid duplicate values. But in sensor and all, because most of the time you will be getting the similar value. That's why I didn't, went to the set side. But set is there. It will only avoid your, the values that are duplicated. Any other question is there, sir?
Yeah, so we'll take one more last question. I think this question is, how does Python compare with MATLAB? Is it better than MATLAB? Something like that.
See, both the things like your MATLAB has a lot of, scientific application. You talk about scientific application you can use in MATLAB. You can also use a lot of filters. So see, both the aspect, we cannot say that Python will replace MATLAB. Totally, like image processing and all, Python is getting now a lot of attention. That used to be in MATLAB, one of the prime factor to use MATLAB, doing image processing or, designing any models and all. But like MATLAB and all these things are now available, right? Those particular part in this Python, like if you talk about OpenCV. So you can develop easily applications related to your, image processing based if you want to develop any application related to security, right? Some face recognition systems and all. So you can train your models easily in Python. So I cannot, much I haven't worked on MATLAB side, so I will not be able to give you the clear understanding, because for making any comparison, you need to understand both the side, right? But what I have studied in my graduation more on MATLAB side. So one thing I can say, but Python is more easy at the user perspective side if you have to write programs and all as compared to something called in MATLAB.
Yeah. So what I can add to that is that the MATLAB code is not deployable. You cannot deploy MATLAB code on any device. That is why MATLAB is very good for simulation and for testing and for training, for all of that. But at the end, when you have to, whatever model you have written in MATLAB, whatever code you have written in MATLAB, if you want to deploy it on hardware, you have to convert it into. So currently MATLAB supports C, C++. So there is a MEX compiler in MATLAB, which will convert your MATLAB code into C code. Then you take that code and you deploy that code on the hardware. So deployability is non-existent for MATLAB. Whereas that's not the case with, with things like running Python code on a board. And MATLAB, to run MATLAB code, you would have to install MATLAB. And MATLAB in itself is a very big piece of software. Even if you take the, the minimum set of packages that come with it. So that way it's quite different from Python.
Correct. That's perfect.
Okay. So when you send me the slides, can you also suggest some good books on in learning to program Python for IoT applications.
Okay, great.
On behalf of IIT Goa and personally myself, and on behalf of all the participants, I would like to thank Mr. Bhupendra Singh for this nice introduction to Python, with a flavor of how to use Python for IoT applications. And tomorrow we have three sessions, all of which will be conducted by Mr. Bhupendra. And you will find that, you know, his experience, he has taught in CDAC school also. So I have been told that he has been one of the most favorite instructors there. So you will find that, you know, you will get to learn quite a lot from his experience of actually implementing these protocols and other things in Python. Okay. So any website or any or anything like that, that all, I think when you send me the book list or things like that, you could also mention your, any website or something like that. Yeah. And of course, people have asked for your email ID, so you can include that on your slide, so it will go to everyone. Yes.
So yes. Is there anything we have to pre-install for tomorrow's class?
Installation, because basic for programming, we require only this. If you have Visual Studio Code or any editor, that's perfectly fine. And Linux environment, and if you want to do exact practice, so you can carry out your Raspberry Pi board, RESP32, RESP8266, any board you have. So I'll give you more clarity on that side. Either at least I'll give you the core demo, and later you can practice that part also.
So one question maybe you can add to that is, like, she is using Windows. Today she was using Windows.
Yes.
So maybe she should do a, you know, VirtualBox installation and then run a Linux VM on there for the next lab sessions. What do you suggest?
That will be good. I think that will be best. Either one option is that in Windows, you can use now, there is WSL, right? Windows Subsystem Linux. So already it comes. So that you can use. So it will give you the bash shell and all.
Okay, sir, I'll do that. Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah. And all of you will get all the recordings. Okay. So for this today's session, I think I will share this recording first because you may want to refer to it before tomorrow's session. But I will edit this session later also, because before I put it on YouTube and all, I have to add some credits and other things. But I will share, I'll try to share this through Google Drive or something, so you can download and then, read it. Okay. So feedback for the courses to submit in Atal portal. Okay.
One more question. Like, I don't have a Raspberry Pi board with me, but Cortex M0 will work fine. That Cortex M0 plus board, that will be able to, we'll be able to do everything, whatever you're going to teach on that also.
No, that, because Cortex M0 board will, I think, will not be having support on like Python and all, right?
Okay.
They will be on, might be, if you give me the exact model number, then I can talk about, like, STM boards you are talking about, STM32F40.
No, it's KL25Z, Freescale boards.
Freescale, I think it will not support. It only have support C++. It means you can only get the data of the sensor, but you cannot send directly to cloud and all.
Okay. Might
you require some knowledge later to extend those SPI I2C with some Raspberry Pi connectivity, because you require at least Wi-Fi or Ethernet, something to, you know, connect your data devices to cloud. So that will be the one restriction from there.
Okay.
So thanks again, Mr. Bhupendra Singh. It was quite good. Okay.
Welcome, sir. It's a privilege to be here.
Okay, so those of you who have not marked your attendance for the day, there's no session-wise attendance. Session-wise attendance I download from Microsoft Teams. Okay, but for your day, you can mark your attendance once on the Google Sheet. If you have already filled it up, you don't have to fill it up again. Okay, and links for tomorrow's sessions I will send by tonight. Okay, so tomorrow we'll begin at 10 a.m. I will ensure I don't make a mistake of starting at 10:30 a.m. again. Okay, so okay, then all of you take care. Thanks, Bhupendra. You also have a good day.
Okay.
And all of you take care. We'll meet tomorrow morning. Okay,
okay, sir. Sure, yeah.